man is forever changing the face of the earth. Glamorgan, like most of Britain, was in former times covered by woodland. But man gradually cleared the forests to make room for agriculture, both pastoral and arable. With the finding of coal and the phenomenal growth of industry in the 19th century, much of the fairest countryside of South Wales was laid waste. Industry crawled along the valleys. The hills were disemboweled of their iron and metal ores. The surface of the land became poisoned and barren. Flowers gave way to sterile waste. Streams were no longer clear and limpid, providing living places for silver-gleaming fish and brightly coloured dragonflies. The very air became polluted, and as the earth's treasures were exhausted, industry moved on, bequeathing a scarred and battered land to future generations. During the 20th century, the enormous increase in population and greatly improved living standards have imposed tremendous pressure on wildlife and the countryside. The building of houses, factories, schools, and roads are eating away prodigious quantities of land, once the home of plant and animal. The motor car and increased leisure have greatly added to human pressure on the countryside. With cities ever increasing in size and number, the relaxation to be found in wild and natural places becomes more essential than ever before, at the very time when man's whole environment is in jeopardy. By 1961, Glamorgan had awoken to this situation sufficiently for a few far-seeing men to be able to establish the Glamorgan County Naturalists Trust. One of the Trust's most important tasks was the establishment and management of nature reserves. And this was soon embarked upon with the acquisition of Broadpool, a beautiful and interesting pond with a golden crown of the rare fringed water lily. Interspersed with white water lily and an interesting community of less spectacular plants. The pond contains a large and varied population of invertebrates, including at least 14 of the 24 species of dragonfly recorded in Glamorgan, some of which are migrants from the continent of Europe. It has been estimated that the pool supports about 8 million larvae of the China mark moth. The pool is visited by many birds, including the heron. Nature herself can be an embarrassment, and the rare and beautiful fringed water lily has spread so rapidly in recent years that it threatens the existence of all other vegetation and could even change the pond itself into a marsh. The management of the reserve therefore includes the control of this plant, and working parties such as this are an essential part of the Trust's work. By the end of the day, the workers were ready to agree with the estimate that the pool contained some 250 tons of water lily. The pool is surrounded by an interesting community of plants growing on the acid soil of Cefn Bryn, made colourful by ling, gorse and purple-gloomed hair grass, amongst which is a surprising amount of white heather. One of the most interesting is the insect-eating sundew, which gains much of its nourishment from the flies which are attracted to its glistening dewy leaves and caught by the sticky hairs. The limestone cliffs of the Port Einan Overton Reserve are a complete contrast. Here, amongst geological strata of great beauty and scientific interest, more than 200 species of plants may be found. As soon as the reserve is entered, such beauties as bloody crane's bill and spotted orchid are encountered. Here also many butterflies, such as the large skipper and speckled wood, flutter on the spray-free vegetation. Moving up the cliff to the plateau, many flowers are seen. Dog rose, field rose, the dainty wild mignonette, outlined against the blue background of the sea. Common mallow. The rare clary. And the uncommon white stonecrop with its fascinating red cylindrical leaves. Across Overton Mere, the glory of the famous South Gower Cliffs can be seen at its best, as the summer sun beats down on the Overton part of the reserve. Among the many flowers found here in profusion are bloody crane's bill, a beautiful and rare plant. Rock rose. Scarlet pimpernel. And wild thyme. The attractive stone trap breeds here. And the yellow hammer. And a kestrel may often be seen hovering overhead. Beneath Port Einan Point, bordering the bay, lies the Sedgers Bank Reserve of some 86 acres. Plants such as golden samphire, and rock samphire grow here. Many wading birds frequent the rocks and sand. Curlew. Turnstone. Oyster catcher, an ill-named bird which does not eat oysters. For study and enjoyment, the Trust arranges weekend courses and field excursions. This party, led by the scientific secretaries, is visiting a South Gower coastal area where, in early spring, can be seen Gower's most famous plant, the beautiful yellow whitlow grass, which grows along a few miles of these cliffs and nowhere else in Britain. Little woodland, typical of past ages, remains in West Glamorgan, and the Trust is fortunate in having acquired some examples. The Hanging Woods, cum ivy, were too precipitous to be worth clearing for agriculture, and so have survived to become a reserve. An example of the natural deciduous woodland of former times, and a quiet reservoir of wildlife. Since the dull November day, when the conservation officer and the honorary solicitor proudly erected the new gate and sign of Gethley Here, a 70-acre reserve which provides examples of two types of native deciduous woodland, much has been achieved towards the completion of the management plan. Paths and glades have been cleared, fences repaired, an observation hide erected. And the work of clearing the pond of fallen trees and other debris continues in the August sunshine, usually led by the indefatigable chairman in person. Even the boat was made by a member of the Trust. Thank you. Welcome assistance has been given by a party of young people from the Conservation Corps who give up much of their holidays to do this type of voluntary work. In recent years, so much marsh and estuary has been drained and the land reclaimed. So many village and agricultural ponds have been filled in and disappeared, and the demand for water for industry, domestic use, recreation and agriculture has become so great that wetland habitats are of particular importance to conservation. Ilston Quarry was worked until 1967, at which time there was virtually no vegetation. In the rock face are two clay bands associated with coal lenses, such as can be seen nowhere else in South Wales, and these are being studied by geologists. The first plant to colonize the bare ground was coot's foot, the flower of which appears in March, long before the leaves. Many derelict buildings have already been removed with the cooperation of the Royal Engineers, who have also constructed a pond beneath the quarry face. The management plan for the reserve includes the removal of the unsightly scar left by the quarrying on the beautiful Ilston Valley in such a way as to increase the scientific interest and wildlife habitats. This working party is planting some 2,000 trees. One side by a stream which, as well as providing the workers with washing facilities, attracts grey wagtail, kingfisher and an occasional dipper. Thank you. Trust is fortunate in having a series of quarry reserves which are examples of different stages in vegetational succession. Here at Ilston, the first stage, bare ground, is illustrated. If left undisturbed, this gradually develops into grassland, as at Lanridian Quarry. This stage may be prolonged indefinitely and the turf kept short by grazing, but without grazing gives way to scrub and woodland, as at Bolgoid Quarry. The Steel Company of Wales has made an agreement with the Trust for their reservoir at Eglwys Nunneth to be managed as a nature reserve. The reservoir was built on Margam Moors, formerly the wintering ground for some 2,000 white-fronted geese and many other birds. This area was thought to be permanently lost to wildlife, until this wise management policy established the reservoir as a refuge for water birds. In the late autumn, large numbers of wild duck and other birds arrive to winter here. Tufted duck, pochard and golden eye. Gulls, coot. A pochard upending. A party of dab chick. Grazing like cattle on the grass. In spring, coot and moorhen build their nests and rear their young. The magnificent great crested grebe here shows a little of its fascinating courtship ceremony. Along the water's edge can be seen common sandpiper. Pied wagtail. Yellow wagtail. And occasionally, the bright flash of a kingfisher. The surrounding vegetation is the habitat of sedge warbler. And goldfinch. and swallows indulge in their frequent preening on the boundary fence. In high summer, the buddleia is much visited by butterflies. Peacock, his long tongue searching the florets for nectar. Red Admiral. Small tortoiseshell. And a drone fly. And common blue. The reservoir, the largest sheet of inland water in the county, is also used by a sailing club and an angling club, a member of which is here seen landing a 9-pound brown trout. What you have seen is only a small part of the Trust's work. You have seen less than half of the reserves, and these, with one exception, have been in West Glamorgan. But the East has much to offer, and much has already been achieved there. The county has awakened. Are you prepared to see your natural heritage destroyed forever? The Trust is not, but it faces a tremendous task. Every county in Britain now has a Naturalists Trust, and wherever you live, your own county trust needs your support. The need is urgent. Time is running out.